thank you all so much for having me. It is such a pleasure to be here with you all and to be part of this lecture series. I hope that I can live up to the others you have seen. You and Cameron was on the list, wasn't he?
Yep, he's coming back.
That got me a little nervous on that one. I remember reading his books when I was young. So, but it's a real privilege to be here with you all. The title that I gave, I hope everyone can see this, we got it to a good size, is Martin Luther and Medieval Context. There was some debate, both in communicating this and internally, about what would be covered in this area. I opted for a more general overview, as I'll explain in a second, but just trying to provide some of the background from the period before the Reformation that helps us to understand a little bit of not only what happened, but why it happened in the way it did. So if we can move to the next slide. This is a bit of an outline. I've also peppered this with a lot of images from manuscripts, which is a little pet project of mine, collecting fun manuscript pictures. So I'm going to give a bit of a historical overview just so that we have a timeline that we're all working with, an idea of what are some important events leading up to the Reformation. There are lots of them. I've tried to include only the highlights. We'll talk a little bit about religious culture in the Middle Ages. What that looked like both in the church hierarchy and also on the ground, and how that developed in a way leading up to the Reformation. We'll talk a little bit about politics and popes, the political role of the church in the Middle Ages that Luther will come to critique, followed by some theological trends in the Middle Ages, and then ending with a little bit of talking about biblical exegesis. So these are going to be really religious culture, politics and popes, theological trends, and biblical exegesis are going to be our four main pit stops along the way. So how did we get to 1517? Given that these lectures, I imagine, are happening because of the build-up to the 500th anniversary of the posting of the 95 Theses, I decided to frame this medieval context lecture around how we got to this event. How it came that posting the 95 Theses was an event that took place, was reacted to in the way that it was, and produced the sort of energy that led to our current situation. So the first question is, how did the culture of indulgences critiqued by Luther develop? The word indulgence, as Luther pointed out, never appears in the Bible. But by the time that 1517 rolls around, it is a major facet of religious life that is important not only to the high laity, people like princes and kings and the church hierarchy on the church side, but also to peasants. It permeates all levels of religious life, this idea of an indulgence. So how did this culture of indulgences develop is probably our first and most important question for the medieval period leading up to the Reformation. The second was, why was Luther's perceived, people debate about whether or not he intended to, but his perceived challenge to papal authority, why was that so incendiary? Why was that such a powder keg, as it has been described by some scholars? How did it become that way? What's the background of papal authority? How did it get to the situation it was in 1517? The third one is a little more broad. What are some of Luther's theological and spiritual influences? What are some of the medieval trends and movements and groups of thought that were important to Luther's own, that will sort of frame the way that he critiques and seeks to reform church practices? Looking ahead to the reception of the posting of the 95 Theses, why did Luther end up before an imperial court rather than an ecclesiastical or a church court? Looking at the question of why this was the case, he was on trial for heresy. We would normally expect this to be something that happened in a church or ecclesial courtroom. Instead, it happened in an imperial court. What's the relationship between state or imperial politics at this time and religious politics? What does their history look like? And then finally, at Worms, Luther makes his famous appeal to Scripture, that unless he can be convinced by appeals to Scripture or by plain reason, he will not recant, for it is not safe to go against his conscience. How does that appeal to Scripture come about? What makes it noteworthy? looking at some of the history of the way that Scripture has been read, and how Luther will ultimately end up contributing to the development of what we call biblical or scriptural reading, exegesis. So these are some of the main questions that I'm hoping this lecture can address by giving you some more historical background and context. Again, I come at this as a historian, not as a theologian. Sometimes those lines get blurred, but really trying to provide some of the background story to all of this. So let's move to the next slide. Oh, actually, let's go back for 1 second. To point out some figures, this is a later painting of Martin Luther allegedly posting the 95 Theses. As some of you may or may not know, there has been a lot of active debate about whether or not they were actually posted at all. Consensus is that they were not nailed, because nailing is generally bad for doors if you do it a lot. He probably would have used glue or paste or tack or something like that. There's been a lot of debate about whether or not he did or did not post them. Some important figures we have, their names will come up later. We have Pope Leo X here. We have Albrecht of Mainz. He's a cardinal and archbishop. We have, over in the far corner, we have the young Emperor Charles V, who is the one who presided over the Diet of Worms, which is right here. This was Luther's main trial, where the famous alleged "Here I stand" moment took place. Yeah, Deutsch. So to the next slide, please. So a little bit of historical overview that I promised you, just to give us some important dates to hold in mind. These are some of the points that I'll be referencing. This goes back much further than what is classically considered the Middle Ages, but some important dates nonetheless. In 313, we have the Edict of Milan. This legalizes Christianity in the Roman Empire. This is under Emperor Constantine. It won't be later until Emperor Justinian that Christianity becomes the state religion of the empire. But it is this moment in 313, when it is legalized, that it really begins to gain the momentum that will define the church through the Middle Ages up to the Reformation. The Council of Constantinople in 381 finalizes the Nicene Creed that was first drafted at the Council of Nicaea earlier that century. This will be the main, this creed, which you all probably say in worship, at least when you're not saying the Apostles' Creed, will become the sort of the main definition for a legal standard of Christianity throughout the empire. It will become an important part of the church's self-understanding as we go on. Being part of the Roman Empire was also an important aspect of Christian understanding. It will be why we have this thing called the Holy Roman Empire later in the Middle Ages. So when Rome is sacked by Vandals in 410, this is a major part of the church's understanding of its Roman heritage, a main blow to that when Rome is sacked. St. Augustine, who many of you all might know, dies in 430. He is generally considered to be the last of the early church fathers. After him, we sort of classify most theologians and thinkers as part of the medieval era. The fall of Rome, and that is in scare quotes, because people generally don't consider Rome to have had a quick sort of fall that we can point to a date, but rather a general decline over time. But the general point we point to, if there is a fall of Rome, is near the end of the 5th century, in 476. 590 is the beginning of what are called the Gregorian Reforms. These are a set of reforms of the church under Pope Gregory I, also known as Gregory the Great. A major part of the Gregorian Reforms are to make the clergy of the church more like monks, to monasticize, we would say, the clergy. This is where we start getting the ideal of clerical celibacy as a standard for clergy to come about. It won't be actual church law until much later, but the Gregorian Reforms are a big part of the way the life of the clergy is shaped. That will become part of Luther's critique over the inability of the clergy to marry in the 16th century. This is also around the time that we see the Christianization of some of the further parts of Europe. Christianity came to England during the Roman Empire, but after its influence receded, Christianity sort of lapsed in those areas. New missions were sent out to re-Christianize those areas. The famous one is a different Augustine, this time of Canterbury, who Pope Gregory sends to be the missionary to the English. Skipping ahead for a couple hundred years, we have in 800 that Charlemagne, or Charles the Great, is crowned Holy Roman Emperor. This isn't a Roman Empire by any means, but it's looking back to the Roman Empire as a sort of a Christian, religious, and secular authority. The Holy Roman Empire is a major player. Luther is technically a part of the Holy Roman Empire, though it looks much different than it did under Charlemagne when he goes on trial. This is why the then Holy Roman Emperor of Charles V is the one who is in charge of the proceedings. In 1054, we have a major moment in the history of the church, which is the Great Schism between East and West. This is when the Pope in Rome and the Patriarch of Constantinople excommunicate one another and severs Christianity in two. This is why we have Eastern Orthodox and Roman Catholics and everyone else in the West as distinct groups. It goes back to the 11th century and this mutual excommunication that takes place. All the reasons why that happened are far too many to get into. They involve such wonderful minutiae as liturgical complaints, when the date for Easter will be, all these classical things that people continue to rehash to this day. In 1100, a book called the Glossa Ordinaria is compiled. This is Latin for the ordinary gloss of Scripture. A gloss is a commentary, and what was published around this time was an edition of the Bible with margins containing quotes from the Church Fathers. This becomes one of the staples for all theological and biblical research from that point on. Later, a man named Peter Lombard, who we'll talk about, will put out a commentary, a list of readings of the gloss, and that will be the main textbook for the Middle Ages. It will be what Luther and all his contemporaries learn from in their time. The Glossa Ordinaria, with later Peter Lombard's sentences, they're called, or his commentary on them. We talked about the Great Schism. Well, there's also a Great Western Schism, because clearly we didn't have enough of that. This begins in 1378. I'm going to talk more about how this happens later, but I just want to put that date on the map. So 1378, the West Schisms. This is finally ended in 1417 with the Council of Constance, when the schism is ended. So put a pin in that, we'll talk more about it. Finally, the Council of Constance begins in 1414. This is the last major church council in the West before the Reformation. It will include the burning of Jan Hus, who is considered to be a forerunner of the Reformation. Martin Luther will be accused by his opponents early in his career of being a Hussite, or a follower of Jan Hus, reminding him that, of course, Jan Hus was burned at the Council of Constance. Luther will review Hus's work and say, you know what, I am a bit of a Hussite, and you shouldn't have burned him, and here's why. So this becomes a major reference point for the early debates of the Reformation. So this is by far, hopefully, the driest portion of the presentation. Thank you for sticking with it. While we now proceed to talk about the religious culture in the Middle Ages. Here is an image from a medieval manuscript of a funeral procession. Back then, white was not the liturgical color. People used black. Very dour. You have someone here who's clearly royalty, crown, and a scepter being held. You wouldn't get this many clergy to show up if you weren't someone important at your funeral. So let's talk a little bit about religious culture in the Middle Ages. Before I talk about that, let me just say that one of the difficulties we have in doing historical research is penetrating the intellectual culture to get an idea of what life was like on the ground for people who weren't literate. Most of the sources that we have in history are by people who wrote things. Sometimes they write about things that aren't themselves, but only the things that really interest them. It's why we have a lot of biblical commentary from a period, but not a lot of accounts of peasant life. The literacy rate in this period is going to be very low. Less than 5% of the population at any given time is going to be literate. And most of that literature and those literary people are within more or less enclosed communities. You couldn't be guaranteed that your parish priest knew how to read, only that he could look at the words and make the Latin sounds that accompanied them. So we are going to struggle in a bit to try to figure out what was life like for the average person in these times. Because the literature we have to examine the period is not the records of average people, but of those select few in a society who have the ability to read and to write, and whose readings and writings were important enough that people would copy them down and pass them on to future generations. But that little caveat, let's talk a bit about religious culture in the Middle Ages. So what are some of the important facets of religious life in this period? The first thing to say is that it is a sacramental life. Sacraments of the church are important, though people did not participate in them in the way that we might think of participating in the sacraments at all times. The three most important sacraments of the church at this period are going to be the Eucharist, baptism, and confession. Now, the Eucharist is going to come down a little bit later, but at this point we have an image right here from a manuscript of a priest presiding at the Eucharist. Here he is, he's a monk because he has his head shaved. You can tell that much. His clothing looks gray. That is a little bit because this manuscript has aged, but green in this period is often a lot grayer. So this would be a chasuble from ordinary time. You'll still see this preserved actually in Swedish churches. They'll have these sort of gray vestments that are actually just a very muted green. And this is more popular in this period for a variety of reasons. So he's here in ordinary time, celebrating communion. He's got a little acolyte behind him holding a candle so that he can see what's going on. Important also to note, though it's hard to tell from this, is that where the priest is facing. The people, if there were any, would all be behind him, not in front of him. Mm-hmm. It isn't until the Reformation that people begin celebrating the Eucharist, what is called ad populum, or towards the people. In this period, it's still celebrated ad orientum, or facing east, which is what this priest is doing here. So the Eucharist is probably the central moment of the liturgical life of medieval communities. Now, you might think that that means people are taking the Eucharist often, but that is not the case. In the Fourth Lateran Council, which was the 13th century, there's a little law added to canon law that says you have to take communion at least once a year on Easter. Now, something that historians often do when we're trying to figure out what the life of everyday people looked like is look at things like laws and ask ourselves, what can we glean from that? What can we tell? And a pretty general sort of truism or staple of historical research when it comes to laws is that people don't make laws about things that you're already doing. If people are doing something, there's no reason to make a law about it. You make a law because people aren't doing something you want them to do, or they're doing something you don't want them to do, and you're trying to fix that. So if the church has to make a law saying that people have to take communion at least once a year and on Easter, what might we be able to gather from that? That people aren't taking communion, they're taking communion so infrequently that once a year is something we have to make a law about. People did not regularly take or participate in communion by consuming the elements. And when they did at this period, they only took bread. The wine was reserved exclusively for clergy. There are lots of reasons why that happened. Part of it is because, quite frankly, the laity were terrified of taking communion because it was the body of Christ. And if you did something like drop it or spill it, you have committed a mortal sin. And this was very, very anxiety-producing. Much safer just to watch the Eucharist take place and receive it spiritually. I mentioned St. Augustine earlier, and he actually talks about this practice of spiritual communion. He has a line, why do you prepare tongue and teeth? Only desire, and you have received. People found it generally safer just to desire it, because you couldn't sin that way. And so they would often watch. People would be hanging around in church, they'd be eating, they'd be milling, they'd be talking. People would ring bells and elevate the host. Everyone would look, see, take it in, and then go back to what they were doing. This was a much safer and less involved way of doing things. You also had to go to confession before you took communion. And they didn't have nice boxes for you to do that in. You had to go find the priest, tell him stuff, people would be hanging around, oh, don't forget about this. Put that one on there, he did this to me last week. It was a very public and exposing act that people didn't like to do too much in that way. So the Eucharist was a central aspect, but people only viewing it and receiving it. There's also a lot of lay superstition around the Eucharist. We have all these examples of sermons. People, Franciscans and Dominicans, who were big on preaching, would put together books of stories that you could use in your sermons because preaching at the time was considered to be so bad that anything could help. So if you ever think about complaining about your sermons, not that you would, I guarantee you, everything you have today is so much better than what generally people heard in the Middle Ages. So they had these books of stories they would put together, and a lot of them were about people stealing consecrated hosts from churches to plant in their fields, to make their crops grow better, to put in their beehives, to make their bees make more honey, all these different things. So there was a lot of superstition and sort of mythical thinking around the Eucharist, its magical properties, and people were afraid to come into close contact with that. Baptism was also an essential sacrament, and it was reserved entirely for infants. I know if you happen to be someone who converted later in life, you would of course be baptized, but Christianity throughout the Middle Ages, especially as society becomes more and more Christianized, was so pervasive that it would have been a very rare phenomenon to see. Unless you had someone who was Jewish or Muslim or found an errant pagan off in the woods, most baptisms would be of children, and people were very anxious about having their children baptized early, because that was a prerequisite for salvation. This becomes so anxiety-producing, in fact, that by the time of the Reformation, most baptisms will be performed not by priests, but by women. This is because women will be present at births, and they would want it done so quickly, they would just grab a midwife and have her do it, because she would be on hand. They didn't want there to be any chance that this child wouldn't make it into that essential sacrament. Finally, confession is an important part of the sacramental life. Now, if you're keeping in mind, you say, wait, I thought people didn't like confessing. They didn't, but it was a very important prerequisite for your salvation. To have made a full and complete confession of all your sins was an essential part of getting into heaven. People would often seek priests out in private. Wealthy people would have their own private confessors to hear and take in their sins and to absolve them. Nowadays, for example, when we think about what it means to die well, we often have this image of going peacefully in your sleep, surrounded by family. This is not the image of a good death in this period. No, you wanted a long, drawn-out, painful death, because this was God's way of telling you, you are dying, make sure to get right. Find a priest, make confession, get everything squared away. This is why when Luther dies, there are all these polemics running back and forth about people arguing, oh, did he die quickly, struck in his sleep, or by a heart attack or something? Because this was the sign of the devil coming to claim his own. Everyone is saying, no, he died, and it took a long time, it was very painful, he knew it, he told us all how strong he was in the faith. These things all center around this idea of needing to make a full and complete confession in order to have the ability, the opportunity, to go into heaven. Because these sacraments were so important, this is a very liturgical period in time. And I've got the word imminent under here. Originally, when I was putting this together, I put imminent with an E, like eminent domain, because when you grow up with attorneys for parents, sometimes it changes your brain. But no, this is imminent with an I, which is the opposite of transcendent. It means that so much of religious culture was about coming in contact with the divine, with holy things, getting close. Not the idea that, in a sense, it was far away, though God certainly was, but there are all these ways in which holiness could come in and interrupt your life, and you are trying to get access to that, preferably in a safe way, that wouldn't endanger you. This made religious life, what I've said, is both active and spectacular. There was a lot to do about being religious, and it was very much about religious spectacle. Corpus Christi, or the Body of Christ, was a major festival in the church year, where the consecrated host would be paraded around town, everyone would join in. There are lots of documents detailing what order everyone in town got to march in order of priority and social hierarchy. Very much involved in the life. There's something, I think, off down here. Can you tell me what says it says below Corpus Christi?
Nope, it's cut off on this.
Oh, cut off on there too. Yeah. Well, there's some things that hopefully aren't terribly important. Let me see if I can tell really fast.
Say it all. Nope. That's all right.
I talked way more than I needed to here anyway. We've covered the basics of that section. Let's just move on Mystery is an important part of medieval life also, so I think it's pretty important that I preserve some mystery as what is on these slides.
Nice.
So let's talk about confession, because this is one of the most important sort of personal sacraments to Luther, who is said to have what we call scruples, or sort of this obsessive need to make sure you've made a full confession of all your sins. So how does confession, as a practice, come? So what happens after the sort of fall or decline of the Roman Empire? What does the church look like at this point? This is going to be a very long-winded approach, so just bear with me for a moment. When the church goes into decline, or the Roman Empire goes into decline, the church picks up a lot of the slack in areas where the empire was. Bishops had already become state functionaries, in a way, in the Roman Empire. This is how you have someone famous like St. Ambrose of Milan, who is important to Augustine's conversion. He was baptized so that they could make him a bishop. He had been governor for quite a while of an area, and people decided he would do a good job being a bishop, so they got him baptized and made him a bishop later that afternoon, more or less. Bishops were, in a lot of ways, functionaries of the state, and when the network of Roman imperial authority declined, the network of church relationships of bishops remained, and they picked up a lot of this slack in governing and helping to assist local areas maintain themselves. The side effect of this, however, was that bishops became even more sort of secular functionaries, much more worldly, we might say, and involved in the day-to-day affairs and, you know, getting their hands dirty, quite frankly. There's that line, I think, from Spider-Man, right? That absolute power corrupts absolutely. The more worldly power bishops got, the more worldly they became. And this became a major complaint among a lot of laity and church officials at the time, that bishops had sort of become too worldly, not religious enough. Who fills in some of this religious gaps? Well, Christianity had actually spread much further than the Roman Empire by the time of its fall, all the way out to the far reaches of Ireland and Scotland, where many monastic communities had found. The type of monasticism that they practiced was very different than the type that was founded by Saint Benedict, if you may have heard of his name. The Benedictine form of monasticism was very much about staying put, staying inside, praying a lot, and generally being removed from the world. Celtic monasticism, however, had different features. They were mendicants, which meant they wandered around. This will be revived in later monastic traditions like the Franciscans and the Dominicans, who are known as mendicants, Latin for basically people who walk around a lot. They were solitary. They would go out by themselves, walking around the world, living their very disciplined, ascetic, sort of stripped-down monastic life. You know, wouldn't eat rich foods, would pray a lot, would be very big into self-examinating. And practitioners and encouragers of people doing religious self-examination. They were very important in the re-Christianization of Europe after the collapse of the Roman Empire. When that sort of structure for Christianity, which had married itself to the Roman Empire, removed itself, these monks wandering around what is modern-day France, Spain, and into Germany became very important for the revival of Christianity in these regions. And they brought with them this practice of confession, of rigorous self-examination, and of confessing to other people what you had done wrong. They put together books to help guide people in this practice as tools for pastoral care, helping people to examine themselves, figure out how grave their sins were, and what would be a good way to atone for that. Oftentimes today, we think of sin as something involving us and God. This is not the case. Sin in this period has two major effects. It damages the relationship with God, and it damages the relationship with communities. We often think about this when we talk about things like social justice. The weight of the brokenness of the world breaks society. The idea was that in confession and absolution, you made yourself right with God, but you also had to make yourself right with your neighbors whom your sin had damaged. If you steal something from someone, that means they don't have it. If you cheat someone, that means society is injured. If you violate someone else's marital relationships, society has been broken and you need to help fix it. These books were helping people figure out what is the appropriate sort of way to go about repairing that societal damage. This is basically the beginning framework for the pattern for confession and absolution and atonement, which are major aspects of the spirituality in the late Middle Ages when the Reformation comes about. Something that I know has been cut off down here, because it's very, very important, is the idea of Wehrgeld, or blood money. This is an idea that comes from the sort of pagan German society, modern-day Germany at the time. The idea that when you've done social damage, one of the ways to fix it is by paying money. Blood money literally means if you kill someone that you shouldn't have killed, you can give some money to make it right. And this idea also comes into these practices. The idea that giving money, paying restitution, can be a way to fix problems. The social effects of sin. We have this in our society today. Think of some misdemeanors, right? You can do a certain number of hours of community service or pay a fine. The idea that money is an alternative path enters this process at this point, which leads us to, if memory is correct, the next slide, indulgences. You were wondering how these came about? Well, it has to do with the way that money enters this process of making restitution socially for sin. The process of being absolved by a priest makes you right with God, but the process of repairing that social relationship is part of where money comes in. This is one of my favorite woodcuts of all time. It is from the Reformation, so looking ahead. Here we have a fox in Dominican garb, so he's dressed up as a Dominican friar, and he's selling an indulgence to this chicken. In case you wondered what foxes do to chickens, they put that in the background so you can see there. This is what they do. The implication here, of course, is that these religious foxes are preying upon these peasants here by selling up indulgences. To explain indulgences, we have to talk about how this pattern of confession and absolution produces what is known as the medieval economy of salvation. The medieval economy of salvation is based around the notion of God's holiness. Now, at this time, the best adjective to describe holiness is that it's fire. It's like a fire. It burns. Mm-hmm. And the way that elements are understood in this period is that fire consumes anything which is not also fire. Anything you put in a fire that isn't fire will be burned. Fire doesn't burn itself up because it's already fire. Don't ask. That's just how it worked in people's minds. So, God is holiness, and that holiness is like a fire. This goes back to, I think, Hebrews, where for our God is a consuming fire, it is written. And this is understanding of what it means for God to be holy, that God is like a fire. If you want to be eternally in God's presence, therefore, you've got to become holy yourself. Be like that so God's holiness does not burn you up. Now, original sin has created a huge problem for that. You've got sin already at the start. You're beginning at a deficit. Baptism fixes that, though. It makes everything right. You are perfectly good to go after you're baptized, if only you didn't keep sinning. Don't worry, though. We've got a sacrament for that, is the sort of marching order of the medieval Catholic Church. We have a sacrament for that. It is confession and absolution. This is how you right that sin. Now, you get forgiveness through the act of absolution, but the process of becoming holy enough to be in God's presence, that gets worked out in the penance that you do and are prescribed when you go through confession. The pattern for this is contrition, confession, absolution, and then penance. Contrition, I feel bad. Confession, I tell the priest that I feel bad, and this is why. The priest absolves me and gives me penance to do. I do those acts of penance, and I'm good to go for heaven until next time we have to rinse and repeat. Now, unfortunately, people, except for the really, really holy, were not that good. And they incurred far more penance than they could do in a lifetime. This created a pastoral care process. There's also discussion of inflation. You laugh, maybe, or not, when I use the words like economy and inflation, but this is really how this worked. A notion of inflation, that things accrued more and more over time. Some sin, you know, got worse over the generations and needed more and more years of purgatory or these acts to get off, to take off of your sort of ledger sheet. So people would end up with basically a lot of time in purgatory that they had to spend. Purgatory was this holding tank for people who were going to go to heaven eventually, but just had to get holy enough. The problem with that, though, is that no one in purgatory knew they were in purgatory. They all thought they were in hell. And it was supposed to be a pretty miserable time, all things considered. So the church, in its infinite mercies, had a fix for this. Luckily, Christ, you weren't very good, but Christ was excellent. And the saints were all pretty good, too. They were so good that they stored up all these extra works of merit, these good deeds, that can be used for you to help reduce that time in purgatory. This is called the treasure of merits, and they were dispensed through the Pope by indulgences. So by an indulgence was getting yourself a little piece of that treasure house of leftover merits from the saints that would help reduce that time in purgatory. Here's the kicker. You didn't have to get them just for yourself. You could get them for other people. Your aunt, your grandfather, your loved one, your children. There were other ways to go about doing this. You could, for example, give a church enough money to keep a priest full time and to do good works for you. Say mass, say prayers, things like that. Oftentimes, you would take, if you were a noble person, you would take your second, third, or fourth, your unnecessary sons, and send them off to be monks, so that they could spend their whole lives praying for your family and helping sort of keep down your spiritual debt. Anyway, now who has the keys to this treasure house? Why, the Pope in Rome has those keys. And he is the one who is able to dispense these indulgences. There's a lot more that can be said about this culture, but effectively, this is how we get where we are. And the real danger here is how money enters the system. Because what Luther found out, and what he complains about in his theses, is whenever there is a quick path to doing something, whenever you could do it by hand the hard way or just pay for someone else to do it, people are going to pay to get it done. That is by far the preferred treatment. So what he found was that instead of doing works that he considered good, things like praying, giving to the poor, people were instead doing these easier things, looking at relics, buying indulgences, as ways to pay down their debt. And that this practice had begun to rob Christianity of some of the actual good things that we were called to do. But this isn't about the Reformation, this is about medieval background, but this is how that practice that Luther will be critiquing primarily in the 95 Theses comes about. So let's move on to the next slide. I'm taking a lot of time. Politics. Ah, everyone loves talking about politics these days, I've noticed, looking at my Facebook. I tried to refrain from as many parallels as I could today, though I might on the fly toss a few in. Up here at the top, we have an image from a manuscript of what's called the Donation of Constantine. This was when the Emperor Constantine allegedly gave a ton of territory in modern-day Italy to the Roman Catholic Church. Around the time of the Reformation, people realized that this was a forgery later on to justify papal claims to having a lot of land. This is one of the main things that will annoy people about the papacy in this period, is realizing that a lot of things they'd used to prop up their authority had in fact been later forgeries. But this is a major moment of understanding the papacy as a political institution, that they have governance over a certain area. So here we're going to look at a little bit about how the political culture and the church within developed through this period in time. We have to start with the investiture controversy. Investiture is a fancy word about giving people power. Who invests a bishop with their power and authority? Why would anyone outside the church care about this? Well, go back to what I was saying earlier about the way that indulgences developed. Bishops, after the decline of the Roman Empire, took on a large amount of civic authority. By the time the Middle Ages is in full swing, they will have feudal power. The feudal system basically means there are individuals who control a vast amount of land on which people work and give them the proceeds for that work. Bishops will be feudal lords. They will have people under their control, not just peasants, but also knights and other minor lords. Civil rulers will want to know that the bishops in their territory are loyal to them, that when they tell their bishops that they want all those troops to come fight for them, that the bishop's troops will come and not fight for someone else. Bishops, in this sense, have the same sort of role in society in part that a duke or an earl or a prince might have. There is also the notion that some areas will have both prince bishops. There'll be actual areas ruled entirely by a bishop, with only the Holy Roman Emperor above them or the Pope in some sense. So this becomes a major question. Who gives that bishop their authority? The Pope certainly has a vested interest in that, and the Church does, because that bishop serves a major Church function. They are very important. The Church continues to battle in maintaining a theological orthodoxy, and they want to make sure that some buddy-buddy of the local prince isn't actually an Arian or some other terrible, horrible, no good, very bad theology thing. Of course, as I just mentioned, the local lords are invested in who these bishops are because they want to make sure that you haven't sent some Italian to be bishop of my area who's going to side with the other Italian when he comes to invade my territory. You want to make sure that he's going to be loyal to me because he's in my kingdom. So, before this period, this 11th century scuffle, mostly princes were winning this fight. They had the majority of control in nominating bishops. I mentioned Charlemagne earlier. He was very insistent on picking all the bishops in the Holy Roman Empire, and the Pope, who very much needed his political sort of support, was fine to let him do it because he kept him from being overtaken by the Lombards and other important, but less papal-friendly people. This, however, led to a huge problem called simony. This happens to go back to Simon the Magi in Acts, who tries to pay Peter, etc., to give him the gift of the Holy Spirit. This story is what lends its name to the practice of buying church offices. The problem is, again, these bishoprics had a lot of authority. They came with land, they had money attached, they had authority, power, might. And it was a very popular sort of thing for you to, again, push your second, third, and fourth son off to. My first son's going to get my territory, but I'm going to get my second son to be this bishop, and that way he can have some authority too. So people would pay money, and or rather people would sell off these bishoprics to people to recoup the losses, because you're going to get income from it, you should buy it. It's an investment piece. Goes well in your portfolio, so to speak. The Church has a lot of problems with this, as you can imagine. And around the time of the 11th century, Gregory VII becomes pope. He is a monk and decides that we need a further monasticization of Christianity. It is no coincidence that he chose the name Gregory, just like it is no coincidence that our current pope chose the name Francis. They're all looking back to someone who is important to them. Just as the current pope looks to Franciscan, Francis of Assisi, and his spirituality as an influence, Gregory VII looked back to Gregory I as this great moment in the life of the papacy in which it reformed the church and society at large, and he seeks to do the same thing through what are called the Gregorian reforms. There are two important decretals, or sort of proclamations by the Pope in that period. The first one is In Nomine Domini, or In the Name of the Lord. This establishes the Council of Cardinals who elect the Pope. Up to this point, the Pope was elected sort of by the local jockeying of Italian nobility with church officials. It was a more blended secular and religious process. That distinction is very modern, but we're going to port it in here because it's helpful. With In Nomine Domini, now only church officials are selecting who the Pope is, and this pattern continues into the present day. The second one is Dictatus Papae, and I wanted to put, if we had more time, some examples from that up here. This is the saying of the Pope in Latin, and it is about papal authority, what the Pope has control over. Mm-hmm. Sort of a declaration or almost a wish list for authority, because they're declaring it because in some part they don't have it and they think they should. But this becomes the high watermark and the benchmark for papal authority. This is the most powerful right here that the papacy ever gets with Dictatus Papae. Basically, among other things, declaring that the Pope is the above all kings and has the power to depose kings. And this is where the Pope begins to throw his weight around and say, if you don't do what I want, I will excommunicate you. Now, some of the more practical rulers would say, what's a little excommunication? The problem here, they cared a lot more than I'm making it out that they did. But the real problem here is that if your ruler was no longer Christian, they have a policy of Christians not being in servitude to non-Christians. So if your ruler is outside the church, guess what no longer applies? The oaths you swore of fealty, of obedience to that ruler. So by excommunicating a king, you effectively free all their vassals from any responsibility toward them. This becomes a big deal. It leads to a huge showdown between Henry IV, the Holy Roman Emperor at the time, and George... Greyorg? Why did I write that? No, it just looks like that. It's George. George. It should be Gregory the Seventh, not George the Seventh. Computer wants me to be more English, apparently, than I should. Gregory the Seventh, a showdown between those two about papal authority. This ends up in a huge, long, protracted fight. It includes some military action. It includes a lot of political maneuvering. Here on the far left side for you all, we have an image from a manuscript of Henry IV interceding with an important abbot and prioress, trying to get them to resolve this conflict with the Pope. It gets cut off at the bottom, but eventually this problem is resolved in 1122 with a bit of a live and let live. The idea is that the secular ruler will invest the bishop with the lance, or their military authority, so that as a military agent, bishops owe their loyalty to their overseeing temporal ruler, their secular lord. But that it is the Pope who invests the bishop with the ring and staff, or crozier. And that way, all religious authority is owed to the Pope. This becomes sort of a division of authority that works well enough. This is the precursor both for the modern nation state and for, in a sense, the modern division between church and state that we have. This is where we see that first sort of recognition of two different powers and dividing them up take place. Now, from this, you might think the papacy comes away with quite a lot, and you'd be right. However, something happens shortly after this, short in history terms, like 200 years, which throws all of this papal authority for a loop, and that is the Great Western Schism. I mentioned this earlier for something to put a pin in. Again, this should not be confused with the Great Schism, East and West, in 1056. This hat begins with a period which is known as the Avignon Papacy. Avignon is down here in the south of what is modern-day France. This is known as the Babylonian Captivity of the Church, until Luther took that name for a treatise of his and it got a second life. Here on the far left side for you all, that image you see from a manuscript at the time, it's got Rome as a poor, widowed beggar woman lamenting the fact that the Pope is no longer there. I mentioned the rise of the nation state earlier. Nations are becoming a thing. The first on the scene is the Kingdom of France, which is really throwing its own weight around as a French country for French people. And it is fine. It is still doing that. That is how France is today. They'll make fun of you if you don't speak French as well as they would like. And they get into a power struggle, basically, with Rome about church authority and authority over their own clergy. A sort of concession group manages to push through, and they nominate Clement V, a Frenchman, to be Pope. He is elected and promptly moves the papacy to Avignon, in French, and not technically the nation of France, but in an area aligned with the nation of France. It's effectively France for everything that matters. This becomes a catastrophe in the mind of sort of more traditionalist clergy who feel that the papacy has become, in a sense, politicized now. That instead of being this alternative to political authority, it has become the lapdog of the French kingdom. And for the next long period, from 1309 to 1377, we will have only Frenchmen become popes. This ends, however, with Gregory IX. I wanted to put more images. This is the castle for the Avignon popes, which is still there. You can go visit today. It's exactly that daunting. This ends with Gregory IX, who moves the papacy back to Rome with much celebration. Unfortunately, he dies after 8 months, and there becomes a huge succession crisis. He dies after 8 months, and Urban VI is elected, and the cardinals have instant regret. It's hard to piece together from manuscript evidence what exactly was wrong with him. He might have been mentally unbalanced. He might have just been a jerk. No one quite knows. But everyone felt like this is a terrible decision that we have made. In this period of very rough transition, where we're trying to get the papacy back on track. What do those cardinals do? The same group of cardinals goes back to Avignon and elects another pope. Oh dear. Now we have two popes. Two popes who were both validly elected. by the rules of the church. This creates a major problem, because all sacramental validity comes down to the church through the Pope, who is viewed as the vicar of Christ. So each group thinks the other group's sacraments are not the right ones, and aren't working, and everyone's freaking out about whether or not their communion, their baptism, their Eucharist is a valid sacrament or not. Here we have a map, basically, of how things divvied up. It's hard to see in the colors. This swath right here is Eastern Orthodox. They're not a part of any of this. They're probably just eating popcorn and laughing a little from the sidelines. The light regions here, those are the ones following the Pope, who is now in Avignon. No surprise, most of France is part of that. This is because that Pope has more French allegiance. The green over here, the Holy Roman Empire and modern-day Germany, Hungary, the Scandinavian countries, and all of England except for Scotland, that probably went the other way because the English went one way, they're going to go the other. That's how the Scots work. I can say that because I am Scottish in background. They are all following the line of popes descending from Urban VI. So now we have two separate lines of popes. The Urban VI and all the cardinals run off, appoints new cardinals, so they each have their own college of cardinals, they each have their own sort of courts, and now we have two popes vying for authority. When they die, their cardinals continue to elect new popes, and now we have two different lines of popes. At this point in time, people were wondering that maybe popes as the top authority were not the best idea. Maybe church councils would be a good idea. Maybe those should have the most authority. They remember the early days, councils of Nicaea, and then they were seemed at this point a good way of doing things. So this is where the conciliar movement, or the idea that councils should be the highest governing authority in the church, really starts to build up steam. They decide that they will call a council and fix the problem that way. They call a council, they elect a pope, the other two don't step down, and now we have three popes. There's really starting to multiply, and people are getting anxious. This creates a huge problem, so what do? The conciliarists try again. They convince one of the popes to call a council in Constance in 1414, under the premise that if he's the one who calls it, it'll pick him to be pope. Well, the council had other ideas, deposed all the popes, and called a new one. Everyone decided they were tired of this, that pope stuck, because they got a pope to call the council. That was the rejection of the first council, was that no valid pope called it. They got one of the three popes to call the council, immediately deposed all the popes, got a new pope, that's Martin V. Now we're back on track. But the papacy never quite recovers from this legacy, and it is extraordinarily sensitive to challenges to its authority. This is going to be one of the reasons why Martin Luther, even insinuating that the Pope does not have the ability to forgive sins in to remit punishment in purgatory, will go off like a lead balloon. And really cause a lot of problems. Because the papacy has had a rough couple hundred years. All right, let's talk about medieval theology and spirituality. Enough of this politics, enough with all this. Let's talk about theology. That'll stir the people. A couple images here. Sort of faded in the background, we have an image of the Tree of Life. This is an important sort of tool for a fellow named Bonaventure. He's an important theologian in the Franciscan tradition. Over on the left, we have Hildegard of Bingen, a nun and a mystic. Up at the top, we have just a classic image of the Trinity from this period, which was a major sort of object, not only of theological inquiry, but also of religious devotion and meditation. So let's look at some theology and spirituality trends. The most important trend in the entire Middle Ages, sort of it's the Middle Ages qua, or defined as Middle Ages, is by far and large scholasticism. Now, scholasticism begins really of the 12th century, but it has roots going earlier back. Centered here, what a lovely looking human being we have, Thomas Aquinas, the probably the most famous theologian of the Middle Ages, really probably second only to Augustine in the history of church and theology. On his right, your left side, is Aristotle. Over here we have Plato. And down here we have what is looks like an erstwhile student. The Latin at the bottom says, this is the true light of the church. the advent of all of the way of all ways of discipleship. Rough translation. He is sitting here holding a copy of what is presumably his Summa Theologica, his sum of all theology, his major theological work. Levitating above, we see what is, I would speculate most likely, an elevated consecrated post. We're going to talk a little bit about transubstantiation, if you've ever heard that word. Probably, I feel like it comes up a lot. But that might be just in the circles that I run. Who can say? Some notable figures in this period, really a precursor to Scholasticism, is Johannes Scotus Eriugena, another good Scot. The first major one, however, is going to be Anselm of Canterbury. He was the Bishop of Canterbury in the middle of the investiture controversy. He sided with the papacy over the King of England, and therefore had to spend most of his time as Archbishop elsewhere, because he couldn't stay there anymore. But he wrote a lot of important texts, including Cor Deus Homo, why it was that God became man. His Monophysion is a major sort of precursor to modern, by modern here I mean 13th century, Scholasticism of Aquinas. Peter Abelard is also in that period. You may have heard of the tragic tale of Abelard and Eloise. He's a good reminder to all PhD students who get too full of themselves. He was a very cocksure, sort of young, up-and-coming scholar who was a tutor to a lovely young lady, got her pregnant. Her uncle and ward found out, decided to have him castrated. And his reputation was very damaged. He lived in life as an abbot, but wrote a lot of scholastic treatises. Alexander of Hales is another major 13th century scholastic thinker, along with Aquinas. Alexander is a Franciscan, Aquinas is a Dominican. That's sort of like the, what is it from West Side Story? The Jets and the who?
Sharks.
The Sharks and the Jets, yeah. Kind of like that at the time. Two rival mendicant orders vying for turf. They get along much better now than they did back then. The model of scholasticism and the way it was sort of formatted was a format around a classroom, a question and answer environment. Normally a question would be posed, and almost the opposite answer would be proffered. So you'd have a question like, it seems that unfit, like, did God become a human being? Well, it seems unfitting for that to be so, and here are all the reasons why. So it would list all the objections to the ideal. But then it would say, but on the contrary, it would give the affirmative position and then list all the responses to the objections and the evidence for it. This became sort of a school-based model for theological discourse. It drew heavily upon Aristotle and Plato in two major ways. And this one is really more Aristotle. And I want you all to buckle up, because this is the part where things are going to get trippy. And I'm going to try to hold it together in a meaningful way. The most important thing that they get from Aristotle and from Plato is a distinction between accident and essence. Now, wipe from your mind the notion of accident, or a car accident, or a mistake that you have. That's not what we're talking about here. The best, can this travel with me? Maybe not. I'm just going to be loud for a second. The best example for this is a chair. Now, this is a chair. I've never seen this chair before, but I knew it was a chair. There are other chairs. I bet you have chairs around the corner of the church, chairs at home, that look different than this chair. They might be a different color, a different size, legs might be a different way, but you know that they're a chair. You know that all those different things, even though they look different, they have different sizes, shapes, colors, some might have three legs, some might have four. You know that they're all chairs. All those things that make each of the chairs particular, that help you distinguish one chair from another, those are called the accidents. We as human beings have those too. Some of us have brown hair, some of us have white hair, some of us have no hair anymore. These are all particulars. But we all have a certain humanness that makes us all the same in this line of thinking. So those things which let us differentiate particular human beings, or particular chairs, or particular stools, or anything, those are accidents. But those things which make those things what they are, that about the chair which makes it a chair, its chairness, or my humanness, or the penciliness of a pencil, that is the essence of a thing. This is very much liked by scholastics because it lets them explain how the heck communion and the Eucharist work. Because how does something which in all manner of appearance is bread and wine, how does that become truly the body and blood of Jesus Christ? aha, Aristotle solves this. The accidents remain the same, but the essence is changed. So what takes place is the removal of the essence of bread and wine, that which makes it bread and wine, and the imputation, or the putting in, of that which makes it the body and blood of Jesus Christ. So that in accent, meaning in appearance, in touch, taste, all these things, it looks and seems to be bread and wine, but its essence is that of the body and blood of Christ. This is very exciting, also very controversial. People argue about this all the way up through the Reformation. And in fact, something else I study in this period is the persecution of Jews and Jewish-Christian relations. And around this time, what you start seeing are these myths of what is called host desecration, of Jews stealing consecrated hosts so they can try to crucify it again. Yeah. Now, if you start to think about that, you're like, why? That makes no sense. Jews don't think that's Jesus. Even if they didn't want to crucify him again, which they probably regretted to some extent because everyone was giving them a hard time about it. You know, they don't think that's actually Jesus. Why would they want to do that? It doesn't make any sense for them. But it is a great sort of PR campaign if you're advocating for the real presence of Jesus, body and blood, there. Because if the Jews, who at this point in time people consider to be the eternal enemies of Christianity in some circles, hate it as much as they hated Jesus, then it must truly be Jesus. It becomes a little bit of a campaign to advocate for the for transubstantiation. So this becomes a major sort of period, part of this period, and it relies on this accident-essence distinction that they are getting from Aristotle. Most importantly, the idea that essences have a reality. So that an essence is a real thing that exists out there. It is just as real as the particular chair. Just as real as that chair or this person is the essence of chair or the essence of person. There's some more important facets to this that are cut off right now. The nature-grace distinction, which I won't get into because it would take too long. But the idea that effectively we have a particular nature and God infuses that nature with grace. And that enables us to do works which God finds acceptable. That is the way that this develops over time. It's much bigger than that, and I'm not doing it justice right now. But just letting you know that that's an important thing that also rises in Scholasticism. Let's go to the next slide. Now, if you thought Scholasticism was crazy, let's talk about nominalism. It develops around the same time, and in many ways, it is a competing school to Scholasticism. It has worse art, as you're noticing. This is in part because Scholastics became popular among the Franciscans and Dominicans, who had huge religious orders. The nominalists, not so much. There was this one guy who was kind of nominalist, and he sort of ruined the whole thing for everyone by starting the Reformation. Martin Luther. That was who I was referring to. This begins nominally, there's my little pun, in the 12th century, because it really doesn't kick off until around the late 13, early 1400s. So important figures are Roslin of Compiègne, Jean Bourdon, the name you'll probably recognize, William of Ockham, famous for Ockham's razor, and if any of you all are real Heiko Obermann nerds, you will recognize Gabriel Biel as a very important late medieval nominalist who Luther dislikes with a fiery passion, but who Obermann really wants to resuscitate. The most defining feature here, for the purpose of this discussion, is that nominalists rejected Aristotelian views on universals, namely that those essences had their own existence, that they were real, in a way. It argued that universals and abstract objects do not themselves exist, but that they are only, that they are only names or nomen in Latin, hence nominalism, given to the concrete. So it's our way of taking a concrete thing and understanding, giving a name to it, but it doesn't have a reality like the actual concrete thing has a reality. A good way I found of explaining this is actually bullion versus paper currency. I don't here mean like the thing you put in the soup, I mean like coins that are made of precious metals. So if you have gold bullion, right, its value is the worth of the gold it's made of. Its value is what it actually is tied up in its physical being. But the paper that a $100 bill is printed on is not itself worth $100. It's worth its value. That essence of value that it has is a name ascribed to it, in a way. It is worth $100 because it is imputed that sort of value. But that value isn't inherent to it. It doesn't have a reality. This is why a stock market can crash, and everyone who bought a bunch of gold and hid it in their mattress is having a good day. Would be the difference. So, nominalism explains how a paper currency could have value without having any actual essential value that's based in reality, that has its own real existence the same way the paper has an existence. Some of this is getting cut off. The important nominalist I mentioned is going to be Martin Luther. Now, he has a lot of criticism for nominalism, but he was trained in nominalist schools. That is his background philosophy. And it's going to be the major way in which he critiques Aristotle, the Christian use of Aristotle that he hates, mm-hmm. and Scholasticism in general. Early in his career, before the 95 Theses, there's a disputation against Scholastic theology, where he basically complains about all of this stuff. Here is a plaque in Heidelberg commemorating where Luther probably stayed during the Heidelberg disputation, where he outlined for the first time something that is known as his theology of the cross. As distinct from the theology of glory. This idea that we know God first, chiefly, and only through the revelation of Christ crucified. This, in many ways, is a rejection of scholasticism from a nominalist perspective. It's rejecting speculating about the essence of God, who God is, what God's nature is like, and focusing on the concrete of God incarnate in Christ in this act on the cross. So, this isn't all of Luther's thought, but it's an important background to understanding where he develops theologically at this period. Let's go on to the next slide. Finally, a little bit about German mysticism. I'm going to go a little quickly through this because my voice is going, and also mysticism is a little confusing. Some important notable figures are Meister Eckhart, Johannes Tauler, Henry Sousa, and Nicholas of Cusa. Didn't mean to rhyme that. This is Meister Eckhart. This is Johannes Tauler, Henry Sousa, not pictured, I couldn't find a good one, and Nicholas of Cusa. These are some very famous German mystics that have a profound influence on the Reformation. Particularly, Meister Eckhart and Johannes Tauler were inspirations for a movement called the Friends of God. It was a lay sort of fraternity and mystical society. It was founded in Basel. It was inspired by Eckhart and Tauler. And out of a sister community to them, because it sprung up elsewhere in Frankfurt, comes a little text known as the Theologia Germanica, or the German theology. This was relatively obscure until an Augustinian friar, spoiler, it's Martin Luther, finds it and becomes so enamored with it that he publishes it with a foreword. And it takes off like wildfire. And people have done good work drawing comparisons between this text and some of Luther's early thought. For your benefit, I have pulled out some choice quotes from it and from Martin Luther's Freedom of a Christian. A little small, I might read them out loud briefly. From the Theologia Germanica, God must become humanized in me. This means that God takes unto himself everything that is in me. Now, from the Freedom of a Christian by Luther, rather ought Christ to be preached, that he may not only be Christ, but be Christ for you and me. Mm-hmm. And later, faith unites the soul with Christ as a bride is united with her bridegroom. If Christ is a bridegroom, he must take upon himself the things which are his bride's and bestow upon her the things which are his. Another quote from the Theologia Germanica, and so just to point out there a little bit of this, this notion of Christ taking on to himself all of humanity, both in the incarnation and the sins of the individual, is important for Luther. Later in the Galatians lectures, he will say that faith creates the deity, not in God's self, but in us. The basic God is doing fine at being God without you. God doesn't want to be God, because God already is God. God wants to be God for you, in you. That's what God desires, and that's what faith effects. That by faith, God becomes God for us, which is what God wants to be. Another quote from the Theologia Germanica, this means that God alone works, and I suffer his work and his will to take place. And then from the Freedom of a Christian, Thus the promises of God give what the commandments of God demand, and fulfill what the law prescribes, so that all things may be God's alone, both the commands and the fulfilling of the commands. He alone commands, he alone fulfills. Mm-hmm. So we can see elements of Luther's basic notion that grace alone saves the human being, present in some of the writings of the Theologia Germanica. The idea that all the work that is done belongs to God. We suffer, in more of a positive sense here, the work that God does to happen. Let's move on to the next one. I'm going to interpret that beeping alarm as an attempt to get done fast. Trying to pack a lot in here. Finally, a little bit about biblical exegesis. And this means digging into the fourfold sense of Scripture. This is the dominant, and this is one of the areas that actually touches closest to my research. This is one of the dominant ways of reading the Bible that lasts for over a millennia. And all of a sudden, seemingly in the Reformation, it comes crashing down. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about what this way that for the majority of Christian history people engage the Bible looked like. It begins with a fellow named Origen of Alexandria. There are a lot of other important people, but he is a pretty big one. He is an early church theologian and the driving force behind the formation of the New Testament canon. He developed an early Christian theory of Scripture. Namely, the Scripture cannot be easily understood, and it certainly, when we read it, does not appear to be divine. There's lots in the Bible that's quite frankly scandalous. A lot of the people that we're supposed to think are good and are called good do terrible things. Think of King David. Wrote the Psalms, pretty great guy, kind of got that one guy killed so he could sleep with his wife. For example, Moses, pretty great guy, got drunk. Noah, that one time. Pretty terrible. He put forward the idea that Jesus Christ is the key to the Scripture and argued for three levels of reading. The first one is flesh, the other two, which have been cut off, are soul and spirit. The idea that Scripture has multiple layers to it. So the fleshly understanding might be, you know, how we would actually interpret some of the Song of Songs, like a bit of a love poem between a guy and a woman, which was very inapropos for a holy book. And Romans, other people made fun of us for having such a weird book that was supposed to be holy. But a spiritual reading might be an allegory between the love of Christ for the church. That might be a more soul reading. And an even higher level of reading might come afterwards. I can only imagine what that would be. I've not achieved that level for Origen yet, personally, so I can only speculate. This method of layers of reading the Scripture develops into, if you'll go to the next slide, the fourfold sense of Scripture. And here's a little medieval Latin verse that students would memorize to help them remember this. It rhymes in Latin, and they try to render it here in rhyme, which is nice. The letter shows us what God and our fathers did. The allegory shows us where our faith is hid. The moral meaning gives us rules of daily life. The anagogue shows us where we end our strife. So, the idea that Scripture has four layers of meaning. The first is known. The hard thing is, there's not a standard way of doing this. Everybody has their little own terms, their little different ways of doing it. This is kind of a mashup to understand how it all works. First, you have the literal sense. This is sometimes called the grammatical or historical sense. It focuses on events described and words as they are commonly used. So, for example, if you were talking about the story of the Battle of Jericho, it would be the fact that Joshua and all the Israelites walked around the city seven times blowing trumpets and the walls came crumbling down. That would be the literal sense. We would also have the allegorical sense. Sometimes this is called the typological or spiritual sense, and it focuses on Christ and faith. The way the story can be read to talk about Christ and Christian faith. I'll give an example of that one in a second. It's the most popular of all of them. It's a way to get around some of the problems when you're like, why is this story in the Bible? It doesn't make much sense. It doesn't seem to have anything profitable, but everything in the Bible should be profitable. So what is it really trying to say? The tropological sense is also called the moral sense. It focuses on moral teachings or instructions that can be gleaned from the passage. Finally, what got caught off is the anagogical sense. It's basically what points towards the future, to the return of Christ. more mystical thinkers will be very interested in anagogical readings of texts. So if we move forward, literal sense, I just told you about that. Here's an example of Moses leading the Israelites through the parting sea. By many exegetes, this was considered the crudest or the lowest sense, because it was the easiest to understand and often the least profitable in a spiritual sense in their minds. Exegetes historically disagreed over whether or to what extent all scripture had to have a literal sense. Origen felt that some passages never had literal senses. People often complain about the introduction to Genesis having any literal sense at all, because it seemed very inappropriate to them that God would do things progressively over time. God would do everything at once. God wouldn't do a little bit this day, then take a break because he was tired. It seems entirely inappropriate. There could be nothing literal to it, some people said. Song of Songs is another great example. The idea that there could be anything literal that we should take away from a very romantic, saucy love story didn't seem quite right. So, this is heavily debated, but most scripture is going to have a literal sense for everyone. The next slide is the most important. This is the allegorical sense. This is an image of Plato's allegory of the cave. Plato's pretty important in developing a notion of allegory. I'd explain this later. We can talk about it if you want to. It's from the Greek allegoria, meaning other speaking. It's much, much older than Christianity, as in something Christians came up with. Plato's cave is an allegory for the education's effects on a human being. He uses the idea of somebody trapped in a cave and really see shadows, and the way they feel when they get out and they see the full light of day. Sort of the way about education enlightening the mind. Mm-hmm. The basic principle behind allegory is when a thing signifies something else from what it's talking about. So the best, most literal, which seems wrong, example of an allegory is an actual sign. A sign that says New Brunswick and points that way isn't actually New Brunswick. It points to New Brunswick. It lets you know where New Brunswick is. Mm-hmm. In the same way, when a word points to something other than what it literally means, for example, I'm trying to think, I always do this, I try to think allegory should be a good example. In the Great Gatsby, right, the green light across the sea is an allegory for sort of his hopes and dreams and the unfulfilledness of them. Just like the books around his library can be an allegory for sort of the pretense of his life. All these books and the pages have never been cut, never been read. They're just there for show. It's not actually about the books. The books point to something else. The light means something else. This is a notion of allegory. Augustine is big on this. We'll go to the next one. And this is a good example of allegory from Galatians. Paul uses it too. This is what will ultimately save allegory for Luther, to some extent. Mm-hmm. If Paul does it, it can't be all bad, he has to conclude. But he'll modify that and severely limit it. So we're not going to read through Galatians. You should hopefully have Bibles. I'll encourage you to do it on your own time. Here's one of my favorite ones, though, from Gregory of Nyssa, who's a 4th century, and his Life of Moses. So this is about the time that they send these spies. They've gone to the River Jordan. They want to see what the Promised Land is like. They send some spies over to the Promised Land, and they come back with this big rod between them and a huge thing of grapes hanging from it. Now, we might say this demonstrates the fertility of the land, how rich and bountiful it is, but Gregory knows its true meaning. Quote, "What is a bunch of grapes suspended from the wood, but that bunch suspended from the wood in the last days, whose blood becomes a saving drink for those who believe? Moses spoke to us of this ahead of time when he said in a figure," that's a word for allegory here, "they drank the blood of the grape." This is in Deuteronomy. "By this he signifies the saving passion." Gregory's idea is like, wait, I've seen this scene before. Two spies, or sneaky people, kind of like thieves who sneak, have hanging between them off of a rod, like a cross, a bundle of grapes, which is like Christ, the good wine. This is clearly an allegory for the crucifixion and Christ who will be sacrificed for us. You can see this because elsewhere Moses hit a clue in Deuteronomy talking about they drank the blood of the grape. Grape means blood. This is clearly prefiguring Christ. People are obsessed with trying to figure out that Moses knew all about the Trinity and hid these little signs for us to find later around there. So that's a good example of allegory. We'll move on to tropological sense. Here's an image of the Good Samaritan. From tropos, meaning a way, a manner, or a style. relates to the moral life by way of tropes. So sort of looking at things as exemplars of our moral life. Mm-hmm. It's commonly presented as the way a passage of scripture applies to daily life. So if you're ever sitting around in a Bible study, tired or whatever someone's going on about, and so how does this apply to our lives today? Congratulations, you are doing a sort of form of tropological reading. A little bit of fun tidbit. Last one, the anagogical sense, this is a depiction of some sort of very hectic heaven. From anagoge, meaning elevation, relates to God and higher mysteries, things to come. It often points to judgment and the life of the world to come. The book of Revelation is what people normally point to as a totally anagogical book. It by nature is anagogical. This is the one Luther will like the least. Mm-hmm. Let's go on. Now the question, Reformation, a new exegesis, question mark. This is a very famous painting of Luther preaching from Wittenberg, pointing everyone to Christ crucified. We can go on to the next one. So here's just some tidbits about Reformation exegesis. The Protestant Reformation sought to reform many perceived abuses in the church, including the abuse of allegory and exegesis. Mm-hmm. The general complaint was that allegory had run amok, and it drowned the literal sense of scripture, and that basically you could get scripture to say anything you wanted if you just tried hard enough. Now, this is not a new complaint. Everybody in every generation preceding this complains that everybody before them either over-allegorized or allegorized all the wrong things, and this is the right way to do it. So everyone's sort of tact and sort of justice for their allegory is that everybody else is doing too much of it or doing it in the wrong places, all the wrong ways, I've got it right. Mm-hmm. And in that, Luther is no exception. Mm-hmm. Many reformers believe that allegory had been used to insert human opinions into scripture, allowing opinion to become doctrine. And this is true. The justification for most things like purgatory and indulgences rested on more allegorical readings of passages. Although not entirely. Another day we could talk about all that. Just bring it back every week. The call for scripture alone to be the norm of faith, or sola scriptura, carried with it this critique of the fourfold sense of scripture. Now, Luther is not as hard on allegory as everyone makes him out to be. He does critique Origen, but he likes the way Paul uses allegory. Mm-hmm. Allegory should be indicated by the text, so the text should prompt it for you. Mm-hmm. You can't just allegorize everything. Text should suggest allegory to you. And he draws from New Testament examples, when Paul uses the story of Sarah and Abraham to draw out an allegorical meaning for the issues the Corinthians are having. Mm-hmm. For him, allegory should be a matter of rhetoric, for driving a point home, rather than a way to establish a truth or doctrine. And that's how he sees Paul using it. Paul uses it to make a point more strongly, not to introduce a point into scripture he couldn't otherwise make. So, that is the central difference for Luther between how he advocates for allegory and how others do. This should be the end, huh? We made it. That was a lot. Thank you for bearing with me. I put some suggestions for reading up there if there are anything on certain topics you would like to look into. But I would be glad to, with whatever time I have left you all, this ran long, I think, to ask away any questions. So, please.
Thank you.